You're listening to episode 287 of the Major Issues Podcast, and in this one, we're tackling all the news that's fit to print, talking about the new Superman casting, Marvel fans versus AI, and those box office bombs. The Major Issues Podcast starts right now! Hello, everybody out there in comic book land. My name is George Serrano, a.k.a. The Don. And if you're listening to this, you can only be here for one reason. And that's a brand new episode of the Major Issues Podcast, brought to you each and every week by ComicBookClique.com. And as always, I am never alone. Sir, if you could please introduce yourself.
What up? What up? It's John Escudero here, a.k.a. Yogi.
Yogi is here. And usually we tackle one big subject and, you know, might dabble into some news, some speculation, some rumors. But there has been so many high profile news stories going on in world of comic books and comic book media. We thought we'd take an episode just to try to catch up on all the madness that has been going on. I just started writing down news topics and it just kept going and it just seems to be getting crazier and crazier. So that's mainly what we'll be talking about today. We'll be jumping around from Marvel, DC, some of the Sony stuff that's going on over there, some of the stuff that's going on at Warner Brothers. A lot of interesting things that I'd like to get your take on, but I figure we should start with the biggest studio first, Disney and Marvel.
The big boys.
What do you think is going on? Seemingly, everyone's big. The big thing that's getting everybody nervous is seemingly surefire hits, like a Pixar film, are not surefire anymore. There are films currently that are not doing too hot, whether it be Elemental or the Little Mermaid reboot. We'll talk about The Flash in a bit, but do you think Disney's under pressure right now with some of this stuff that like was surefire before, kind of not bringing in the same investment?
I think they've been under pressure for a few years now, as they had all that turmoil with their leadership because of the lack of results, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like, they're looking for all these logical reasons for things. And it's like, I mean, there's so many factors as to why people aren't really going to the theaters unless it's a big event or unless there's like big buzz, you know, around something.
I mean, COVID in a lot of ways changed a lot of the theater going culture. And
I think it did. I think it did.
Like I instantly think of when Warner Brothers was like, nope, the whole year we'll just put our stuff out on streaming, you know, and that you kind of get spoiled by that.
Did that one guy like mess things up for everyone?
I'm just saying, like, they threw in the towel pretty early. They were like, you know what, we're just not gonna do it.
I know, because it's like that year, I mean, that might have really changed things forever. I mean, other than, what are the biggest successes right now? I mean, you got the surprise one, I feel like, was Mario Across the Billion. But I feel like that was another special case where it was like there was nothing in theaters and it's a big IP and it was over a long period of time, a period of time that a lot of movies aren't even getting these days. There's just so many different reasons, but I feel like the biggest one is the change in movie going behavior, the streaming thing, especially for Pixar, because Pixar, you basically trained parents to wait till it comes to streaming with those movies. Like, oh, we can just do this.
Yeah.
They did it like what, 2 or 3 in a row during COVID. It's like, why would I ever go back with these noisy little motherfuckers? You know, I can put them down here in the house.
I remember one of the big news stories being something like Trolls was like world tour, like it's like one of the highest streamed films during the pandemic, you know, like a lot of those family friendly films were breaking streaming number records during the pandemic. besides that, like, we're also in this weird age where, like, 6 weeks past a film being out in theaters, it's like out on digital. Like, it's a weird sort of turnaround. I felt like when I was younger, it was like a year before it was made into a
cassette. I think it was like 6 to 9 months at least.
You know, and then but now you, like, really, like, if for some reason,
I mean, a couple years ago, 6 months.
Yeah. I feel like for some reason, or, you know, just the way it is now, if for some reason you're not able to watch a film instantly, like, let's say for some reason, for a month, you just keep getting hit with obstacles. If you could wait just a little bit longer, you can watch that from the comfort of your home. Obviously a different experience, but I would imagine for the same families that would be trying to wrangle their Rugrats to go watch The Little Mermaid or Elemental, you could just as much throw a little party at home for the same price, possibly cheaper, and still feed everyone. You know, they get their popcorn, they get their movie, and then you can just roll their asses to bed as opposed to, you know, trying to take a bunch of people kicking and screaming. So, you know, that can't help either. But is there gonna be something? It have to be like a sequel or something, right? Like, what else can Pixar do high profile? Like, what would they're
gonna have to start taking on licenses like Illumination.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say. It'd have to be something that we know.
Remakes.
They can only do so many Toy Stories. I think they are doing another one though.
What's really sad is that Pixar is like one of the premier places for original stories right now. It's like, I mean, in movies, in animation these days, without all the IPs and remakes and sequels, Pixar is always, you know, they have their Toy Story that they always go back to, especially now that they're seeing now that they're having issues with their original movies making money. They immediately announced like Toy Story 5, Frozen 3. We have some IPs, I swear. Do you want a Cars movie? Like, we'll make something happen. But it'll be really sad to see them bank on that, because, like I said, you know, movies like Cars, Toy Story, those were like, they became IPs because of how good they were. You know, if you're not making new IPs, this will die.
Was Strange World also Pixar?
That's a good question. I don't know off the top of my head. I don't think so.
I can't remember. I just remember everyone going crazy about that.
They really feel like putting Turning Red and Raya on Disney Plus was a big blow to the way things go.
Yeah, apparently Strange World was just Disney.
Yeah.
So Elemental has the worst debut in the 28-year history of Pixar.
Consider the marketing too. What was up with that? There was nothing about this movie anywhere.
I just feel like marketing across the board has been kind of crap. I don't know how much marketing has to do with the Writers Guild, but also there's a thing about that too as well. You know, my mom finds out about movies like watching The View, you know, like somebody showing up on The View and being like, oh yeah, I have a movie out. To my knowledge, there's not a lot of late night talk shows, Good Morning America, stuff like that, running, because there's not writers writing for those people. So they're not promoting their stuff.
I think there's especially today with like young people, it's like a lot of internet hype. I don't think internet hype can drive a movie all the way to success, but I feel like it can sink a movie. You can sink a movie if a bunch of kids catch a clip of it on the internet and decide, you know, that 30 seconds looks like trash. Like, I hate your old 2-hour film. And like, that will be the legacy of your movie.
Yeah. Forever. Don't let a bad screen grab come out, man, because.
But again, like the memes and the TikToks and the Twitters and the threads where they thirst over animated character, like I feel like some of that stuff you need to be able to learn how to harness. If I was in marketing, that's what I'd be working on. None of that hello there, kids, old people shit. You know, like I saw a lot of like DC's The Flash posting TikTok memes on their official Flash TikToks and Instagram. And it was like they were getting clowned in the comments because they're bad memes. Like that's that's the gist of it. Like the memes suck.
Yeah.
You might have to start hiring younger, so I'm getting your kids to run the accounts. I don't know how to fix that for Hollywood or corporate America.
I wonder if they did lose sight of things, because like I heard like how not managed, but almost how movies like Lightyear missed the mark on what people wanted it to be versus what it actually was, you know?
It was a weird concept. I mean, like, Think about what they made. Like
think about Chris Evans. Like they didn't even the cast. Movie. That was my big thing. Once they cast Chris Evans in it, I was like, wait a minute, what are we doing?
It's like you took the concept that everybody knows and you removed it entirely, and then your vague attempt to connect it was like, oh, this is the movie that Andy watched in theaters to create the action figure. So you're telling me you gave a videotape, a spinoff? Like, what is this? Like, who
but
is
that
this
level for? Of meta-ness doesn't work for a 5-year-old.
No.
You know, like that doesn't he's not getting any of what is going on there. The time dilation and all this other kind of stuff. It's like Interstellar. Like he's not that's who's that for, you know? Onward, I remember same thing, like that that's the Chris Pratt Tom Holland thing, right? And I couldn't tell you what the plot of that was off the top of my head. And I felt like for most of this Pixar stuff, a very light trailer would kind of lay out the entirety of the movie and you'd be like, okay, I can get with that. I understand the plot. I can kind of get with that. But they're just not firing on all cylinders. And we've seen this across the board. There's almost no such thing as a guaranteed hit IP, possibly besides Batman. I don't know if there's anything that Batman's done that's bombed.
You can still mess it up. I think
I gotta see some of these numbers. I don't know if anything's outright.
I mean,
bombed,
think about the Flash. Think about the Flash. Yeah. The Flash marketing was like Batman. There's Batman in this. There's two Batman.
Yeah.
This is no way home for bat people. Well,
it has nothing to do with the Flash, but there's so many bat people in it.
I think the Flash was another weird situation. Like there was a lot of factors into it. Like one, it's a dead you told everybody this movie doesn't matter like you months ago. You told the main audience, the geeks, the nerds, the people online, like, oh, we're starting over, this movie doesn't matter. And then the casual people hate the star, so like you threw everybody away.
that's really what it is. Like the DC fans would have gritted their teeth and got through it past Ezra because they love DC so much, but the common people, you know, weren't going to. And they, being Ezra, didn't show up to anything. Like as far as press is concerned, they didn't do many interviews because of how much of a hot button topic it was. But also, like I said, it doesn't help that they did the whole Titanic thing of like, this ship is unsinkable. Like this movie's so good, you couldn't even think of any of the horrible things.
That was such a weird marketing strategy. That's such a weird strategy to sell the movie.
Like, it was daring the audience not to watch it. It's like, you know, like you guys.
I promise, it's gonna be so good that you'll want to take someone out of jail. I don't
know. Listen, sometimes all things need are new creative direction. And speaking of a creative direction, Production Weekly seemingly has the rumored plot of the Rey Skywalker solo film. Have you heard of this?
I did. I don't believe that for a second. For a second.
So I'm going to tell the people, roughly 15 years after Rey's victory over Palpatine at the end of Star Wars Rise of Skywalker, the sequel delves into Rey's courageous endeavor to restore the Jedi Order, where she assumes the role of mentor to two promising young students, a girl and a boy. As their training progresses, it becomes evident the girl possesses extraordinary abilities, destined to emerge as a future leader. What can you see through this? What holes do you see?
Yeah, no, that's actually, that's not what I was thinking of.
Oh, okay. So what do you think about that?
That's pretty much, that's in line with what they told us it would be, mostly. I mean, they said it'd be, they said it'd be 15 years in the future. They said she'd be trying to get the Jedi Order back together. There was a much more detailed rumor out there of what the story was going to be and who they were looking at casting, and people were like sharing it.
Like the gospel.
Stupid.
Yeah, because what we're talking about is actually based off of, like, these were also rumors for that Damon Lindelof was working on a film with some of these elements in it. Yeah. So they might have.
He got thrown out.
Yeah, like, yoink. We'll just use that for this.
He's like, but I love Star Wars. It doesn't show here, buddy.
this just feels like. And obviously, there's other films to do it. This is the first one I'm thinking off of my head. Like, Thor, right? Like, the two, you're going to have two people both trying to get the same, you know, achieve the same goals, but one's, like, really, really good at it. So that's probably going to cause the other guy to be kind of a dick when he realizes he's not great at making the rocks float. He's going to start killing. He's going to start killing people. But, yeah, do you think... And we're in, like, literally in the era for it. But do you think all of this is salvageable? The way some of this fan base is talking about this sequel, and especially Rey.
You should have seen the things they were saying about the prequels, my friend. There are some objectively bad mistakes that they made, right, that could have prevented people feeling that way. But ultimately... it's Star Wars. Then people have flocked to Star Wars forever. It wasn't Rey's fault, and I feel like a lot of the fan base knows that. Other than people that just hate girls, you know, like, I get it, they hate women. There's a girl in the movie. She's lead. It's too woke. But most people understand that. Like, we wanted to see something come from Rey. Like, we wanted some type of satisfaction after The Force Awakens. It didn't come. And I think most people are willing to see someone else drive the train and maybe try to give it to us with those characters. Because, I mean, like it or not, they exist in the canon, right? And they will forever. Right. And the fan base is aware of that, and they respect that. And if you came along and you just told a good story with her, it would really change the way people think about things, especially Star Wars.
That's true. I think we're also in a world where there was a time, especially when those films were coming out, that those films would be the only Star Wars stories we tell. Yeah. So, you know, that the saga. And now that we spun out into so many different genres and of television, and even the film projects that we've been hearing about, it feels like the franchise itself can grow further and, you know, bigger than even what we thought. So there's possible direction they could take this character that doesn't feel like they're plodding through the same trilogy beats
what people wanted from. I mean I know when I saw the sequel trilogy was gonna be a thing, I didn't think we were gonna see the rebellion against the Empire again. You know, like,
yeah
like, you know, like, I think we're pretty happy to see, like, she's bringing back the Jedi Order. You're like, shit like that, that's pretty much what we wanted in the first place. Sounds good already.
Yeah, and Daisy Ridley must also be sort of kind of preparing herself for whatever that's gonna be, like, as part of my French shitstorm that's gonna kick up. You think she's been gearing for this already?
I feel like she's already gotten through the worst of it. I think the biggest, the shock of it is already gone. You know, like, you're prepared for it, and you're gonna be so prepared that you're gonna look and you're gonna be like, oh, actually, you know what? It's not as bad as I was. It's not as bad as I thought it would be. And there's a lot of people that actually like me in here. Like, okay,
yeah, it just can't be. It just can't be easy at that age, right?
Yeah,
like, no, especially if you love this, if you love Star Wars and any of that kind of stuff. Like,
yeah, I don't know. Yeah. I would love to see them get John Boyega back, try to redeem his character, because they really screwed him, and he feels it publicly.
Yeah, I would too. Though it's like. Things were seemingly all lined up that pointed in various directions for that character, and then he was given basically no direction. They had to, like, find other things for him to do that weren't vital to the plot, and that was such a departure from how he was initially introduced.
Yeah.
But yeah, he's also somebody that initially got a bunch of hate. Rose Tico, remember that character, got a whole bunch of hate, made Kelly Marie Tran get off of Twitter in general. And I mean, when you talk about these lightning rods of controversy, does any get any bigger than Brie Larson? Like, Brie Larson is the, you know, she's the video game boss currently of online anger. And recently, Samuel Jackson, I guess, was allowed to speak on some of it. He was asked about Brie Larson's online haters, and he said, she's not going to let any of that stuff destroy her. These incel dudes who hate strong women, or the fact that she's a feminist who has an opinion and expressed it. Everyone wants people to be who they want them to be. She is who she is, and she's genuinely that.
Old Sam Jackson. I mean, there's not, he's absolutely right. But what can you do? I mean, again, she's another one at this point that I feel like she's been through the worst of it. I feel like she handled it pretty well.
I believe so as well, but I'm always surprised at the genuine fervor that people like foam. Some people literally foam at the mouth talking about this woman. To me, like, at the worst, she's just not interesting in certain roles. Like, that's the worst I could say about her. It's like,
yeah.
Like, okay.
I think she comes across dry. I think she's a little dry. I can say that. But I don't hate her.
No, and also, like, I saw her in Scott Pilgrim, bro. That was like, you know, like, they changed my life. Whereas Captain Marvel just probably wasn't written for her strengths and stuff, and that all changes. Imagine if you had to base your entirety of your fandom for Chris Hemsworth on that first Thor film. You know, a lot of people didn't dig it. Could have just.
Captain Marvel's so weird to me because it's like, I don't know, when you talk to Marvel fans, big ones, they're like, it's not their favorite movie, but it made so much fucking money. It's like, who?
it broke a billion.
Who went to see this? Where are all you people? How come you don't stand up? Why don't you stand up for this thing?
To be fair, you know, it was Marvel's first female-led film, or the MCU's at least. You know, and that was huge at that time. Wonder Woman wasn't far from, you know, when this came out. So, you know, there was definitely an audience for it. I just felt like I felt like the amnesia angle really handicapped that character. And then, you know, they didn't really showcase Brie Larson's skills. And now you're in a situation where everyone's being asked about that. And we were just talking about the people online and whether or not that's any kind of indication of the real world. Well, like we just said, you know, no one gets more hate than her, but that film made $1 billion.
Yeah.
So
I heard the second one's going to be like a lot better. I think it'll satisfy a lot more people. I don't think it'll cross $1 billion though. I think people are going to try to say, look, that's why it's not a success, because it didn't make as much as the first one.
Golly. Already, but, right? They're already. They're already gearing up their Brie Larson thumbnails. Their thumbnails with the arrow and the red eyes and the woke. Bro, watch. Are you ready for it? And then they have the nerve. Okay, it wasn't the Marvels. There's three Marvels, but they have the nerve to introduce a third Marvel. Can you believe they made up an African American man named Blue Marvel?
How dare they? What's up with these people? Captain Marvel, I grew up with, was a white man. You know, there's only two genders: it's white, straight white male, or political.
You put that sash on, honey. You put that sash on.
You are.
And those knee-high boots.
This movie's political.
Bro, you couldn't make a movie with the OG Miss Marvel outfit. What are you supposed to do with that?
I watched the shit out of that movie, I'll tell you. I'll tell you that much.
The closest you get is like Silk Spectre, right? Like, that's
Close. It'd suck. I'll tell you that. It'd suck.
Yeah, and people can tell when you're trying to get close to something but not really capturing that feeling. That was what a lot of people felt like when they saw the opening credits for Secret Invasion. And then some truth came out. Turns out the opening credits for Secret Invasion were created by AI. Bum bum boom. A lot of people are upset by this. The studio it was designed by Method Studios, and the idea was supposed to like fit the theme of the show, which is like things trying to mimic humans, but with AI being a very hot button topic right now, and the idea being that these programs steal from artists, it made the news. How do you feel about all this?
I don't know, I thought it was pretty dumb because it took up the whole conversation for the episode. I was like, well, now I don't know how people feel about the show. Like, now I don't know how anybody feels about the first episode. Like, did we like this? I liked it. Like, am I alone?
Was it jarring at all to you? Was there any moment where you're just like, what is this? What's going on here?
No, I didn't notice until, like, I thought it was supposed to be weird because, like, scrolls and they're invading and they're people and you don't know who to trust. And I was like, okay, whatever. My wife did, though. She was like, this sucks. And I was like, oh, shit. I was like, okay. I mean, it was nothing special to me. I was like, it's no Daredevil, but if it is AI, I just figured, like, this isn't like internet AI. Like, this isn't an app. Like, they didn't use a phone app that just sources the internet and scours whatever it can find on Google to create this image of Samuel L. Jackson. Like, this is some giant corporation. Like, I'm pretty sure they'll be okay. Like, it's okay. I'm sure they, like, the whole thing about overworked artists and everything, I just thought it was so ironic that people were like, why didn't we give these overworked artists another project they should work on? I was like, oh, this is so weird.
So the big thing seems to be the timing, the idea that right now we are in a writer's strike, and one of the things that the writers are trying to be protected against is the use of AI in the writing process. The idea that you would hire, instead of hiring you for $300, I hire you for $100 because the AI already wrote it. I just need you to make it sound better. I just need you to punch it up. And because I'm not paying you to write the whole thing, similar thing with the art, that you would have the AI produce the bulk of it and have humans kind of fix it through. And because there's nothing currently in legality to deal with how all of this is used, and the idea is that they got this on the cheap. On the cheap
It's
from the
the
back door, while
it's
there's a
the
bunch of people who've been
inevitable
striking.
it's the inevitable argument. Like, this was always gonna happen. Like, we're just walking towards the sea of having jobs replaced by digital means. Like,
It,
we've
this
been
is,
headed towards there for
yeah.
so long, and this backlash was always there waiting to happen. Like,
Yeah.
I mean, and it's not like they're wrong. I don't
No.
think anybody's wrong for wanting to be paid more or wanting to have more opportunities. Nothing wrong with that. It's
Yeah.
just, I mean, what I admire the fight. I'll say that. I just think, for me, it's a little pointless. Like, we're just fighting against nothing right now. You're fighting
I
against
feel
the
like the
wave.
fight changes. I feel like the fight changes, and the reason why it's so fiery now is because of our drastic need for money,
We should,
right?
yeah,
Like,
we're broke and shit.
if we weren't, if these people didn't need this stuff to feed themselves, I would expect that they would find the same kind of joy in still continuing to make their art, and that there would still be a home and a want for that. That's good.
I'm glad that they are fighting back because, I mean, don't you take it sitting down.
Oh,
I just
100%,
personally, I don't have that.
especially if there's unethical means of sourcing this art, right? Like, especially if like some of the stuff that I saw that's kind of iffy is you have an artist like Scotty Young, who obviously has a distinct style, and if you could just type in Scotty Young and whatever and come up with your own series of covers, Are you taking somebody out of a job in that instance? And it, you know, it's just, it's one of those things where I don't know. I can't blame necessarily a company for trying to exploit it when our goal in this country is riches by any means necessary. You understand? Like, I can't, this is just the world that we live in now. We've created the rules where it's like, well, whatever you got to do, so long as, you know, you're the richest. If you have the least amount of workers, if you, you know, look at Amazon, if you basically destroy every mom and pop brick and mortar store, if you undercut, undersell, you know, all that kind of stuff. This is just another leg of that. And I feel like until we realize that all of this is broken, like this means of how we give and receive money and who's of value and who gets to keep a lot of this stuff.
I don't know that stuff ever changes. That's it benefits too many people that have too much power that won't, like, you'd have to do really bad things to those people to change the world. You know, like, there's too many people you'd have to do too many things to make real change. I feel like there's got to be a middle point though. Like, I don't think specifically with AI, I don't think there's ever going to be any string of words. There's no combination of words in this language put together in any form that will stop AI. Like, it doesn't just turn on. There's no button. There's no, it does not end. Like, it will not stop. This is out. It's Pandora's box. It's open forever. It will continue to grow and it will get smarter. And I'm not saying it's going to become the Terminator, but people are going to advance on it and they're going to want to play with it and they're going to want to make it stronger. They're going to want to teach you how to have sex or whatever, you know? Like,
yeah. So, I mean, like, we also are, I think it should also be said that stuff like ChatGPT and stuff like, you know, the AI art stuff, while this stuff is like the hot button and new hotness, we've been using different AI at different levels for years, you know, with our smartphones and stuff like that. It's not like this technology is new. It's just the implementation of some of this newer stuff. And again, I just think it's always funny whenever we come up with an innovation that we all always worry that someone's going to take it and use it for evil in the money sense. And that's what always happens.
Yeah, I mean, it's always going to happen. You know, there's these inevitabilities, right? It's out in the open. It's going to be used. It's going to be used for good and it's going to be used for bad. So we do have to fight back against it. But I think it's a worthless fight to try to just stop it. I think it's a better fight to try to figure out how you can work with it. How can we continue to make all the money we're making now while using these programs to help make our jobs easier? But the problem is the corporations are pushing so far in the other direction. We want to get rid of you entirely. Like, it's McDonald's. You know, I want to put the cash register machine in the kiosk. I don't want you here. So it's that middle point that's got to be reached. That's why the fight is important. That's why I said I'm glad that they do fight, because, like, I hope that if they both push in the opposite direction hard enough, they will meet in the middle.
I made a joke that I see a world where, like, we're gonna start getting DVDs and stuff with, like, a sticker. It's like made by humans, like, you know, like completely made by humans, writing all that kind of stuff. The same way you have like DIY stuff, or you can buy stuff on Etsy that is just, you know, handmade, hand woven, hand carved, any of that kind of stuff. You're gonna start getting some like farm to table movies. It's like, can you believe this was written by a person and then filmed by people and then it was, you know. But yeah, that it's interesting to see what the future holds. One of the things that I know the future does not hold is Marvel's not going to Hall H this year.
Nobody is.
Nobody's going to Hall H this year, which is apparently, you know, after the virtual Comic-Con in 2022, and then like 2021 was still the coronavirus stuff, the cons have not been getting a lot of or at least the same fervor of people coming in, and to the point that E3 is not doing anything anymore, right? Like, they canceled it the next 4 years or something like that.
I think that's done for good. I think they're dead. I think they're done.
And so the big studios seem to be slowly pulling out of the whole Comic-Con process. Now, Marvel, like the Marvel thing doesn't surprise me because they have D23, right? Yeah. Which is with is their yearly kind of convention where they roll out things. I don't know necessarily if they get more for Hall H, you know, like I don't know if it's worth that for them. But I heard also, you know, people who care about this kind of stuff talking about like, well, it would be a shame if Comic-Con went back to being about comics.
That's right. Like, I'm sorry. The comic convention is focused on comic books. I feel so bad for you.
That could still be the big ticket item, you know, comics, because comics still exist and it is that'd a Comic-Con.
Nice. Like, that'd be really nice. They could use that. Like,
yeah. What the fuck? Yeah. Yeah. So they're going to, you know, they're going to still have panels and stuff. They're just not showing anything. Could that tie into another news situation where the month after Comic-Con, Jonathan Majors is set to have his trial?
oh, no.
The biggest piece in Marvel's future, possibly?
I feel like they played it so smart by waiting, because I can guarantee, like, he's got a thing. They've got things coming up. Well, Loki's one. Yeah. It's like, we've got two folders on the desktop. One in case he gets found guilty and one in case he doesn't. Like,
Do you think they gotta know, right? Like, they gotta know what they think he knows or what they think he's...
I don't think they can... No, like, you can never know what's gonna happen in a court. Like, you just don't know. Like, that has to be decided first. They are in stasis. They only know two options on this road. They will either be moving forward with him or they will be moving forward without him. Like, that's it. So that's it. But I'm really glad they didn't just get rid of him, because who knows? You just don't know. You will know though soon.
According to his attorney, they provided video evidence that supposedly, allegedly exonerates him.
And yeah, but like, they said that about the text.
The text
was like, look, I told them you didn't do it. Yeah, I mean, like, it was like the most incriminating thing.
I guess that's what I mean. I guess what I mean is I wonder how sure Disney feels about the allegations
I think it's too human. That's too human a question for a corporation that has too many people. Not that they're robots or anything, there's too many people, too many different thoughts. Like, it's just too many people in charge of too many things, and they're all,
and there's too many jobs, and it's not just his job on the line, right? Because all these projects and stuff have to go.
Millions of dollars.
Directors are on the hook for some of this stuff. Someone wrote Kang Dynasty. So if you're not doing the Kang movie.
And that someone got fired.
Right. And guess what? There's no writers. They're on the strike. You know? So, hey, Kang, what are you doing here? It's going to be a ChatGPT.
Why don't they keep showing your eyes only?
His fingers are all messed up.
My face was ruined in the last battle. I have to wear this.
Now I look like Chiwetel Ejiofor, but
I have more sorcerers. I have an ambiguous face now.
It's gonna be pixelated.
Tony Todd. I'm just Tony Todd's voice.
Oh, I'd love that though. But yeah, it'll just be pixelated the entire time. Like we're not allowed.
He's like a Japanese porn penis.
Yes. I never thought those words would be said on this podcast, but here we are. This is the kind of thing AI does to us. But yeah, I mean, I hope everyone gets what they deserve. I guess
right. Yeah, no, I mean, either, like, I don't have, I can never, you and me personally, I never have any real thoughts about these situations, because I'm just like, if you did it, good, you get what you deserve. If you didn't do it, good, you're free. I hope you get your jobs back.
It is kind of weird to have a hard stance on this, because you don't know.
Not my life either. Like, it's not my life. I can't have a hard stance on somebody's life like that. It's not my life. Like, I'm sorry. That's a weird parasocial thing that I have no interest in. like getting so involved in something like, damn, bro, you did this to me personally. Like, nah, not really. Like, you know, if you lose your job, that sucks, but I'm sure they'll fix it. Like, they're professionals. They'll get it together. They'll get it together. I'll enjoy another movie. Like, I'm sorry that happened to you, but should have been an idiot. You know, like, I don't care either way. So I like memes, though. I do like the memes.
Oh, the memes are pretty funny.
Memes will always be.
Like you said, you know, there's obviously people with their jobs tied up into all this.
Yeah.
And it would be a shame for any of them to lose their jobs because of the turmoil that any of this brings. But what happens when work is so hard that you're not worried about losing your job? You actually leave. Because that's what a new report from Vulture revealed, that 100 artists quit working on Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse due to negative working conditions. The quote, over 100 people left the project because they couldn't take it anymore, but a lot stayed on so they can make sure their work survived until the end, because if it gets changed, it's no longer yours. I know people who were on the project for over a year who left, and now they have a little to show for it because everything was changed. They went through the hell of production and then got none of their work coming out the other side. It was a big shock. It's one of those things where you know, when you find out how iPhones are made kind of stuff.
It's like a
brilliant piece of technology. Oh, some people were exploited for it. That kind of sucks. And while right in the middle of people of this blowing up, and like, this did blow up because the movie's doing quite well, and I think it's a visual marvel, but people are saying, you know, at what cost? Then they asked Amy Pascal about it, and she was like, one of the things about animation that makes it such a wonderful thing to work on is that you have to keep going until the story's right. If the story isn't right, you have to keep going until it is, I guess. Welcome to making a movie.
That did not go
over well. The newest rumors also are saying that Beyond the Spider-Verse might be delayed by a couple of years.
That's no surprise. Like, that is no surprise to me. This movie is just way too complicated.
I think some people were under the belief that because of the early or the seemingly very soon release date, less than a year between Beyond and Across, that both of those films were worked on simultaneously, and we're learning that that's not the case.
That's not even possible.
not with the way they do this. And I think that another reason why people might be I mean, this is important news to, you know, to find out if they are being exploited to this point and if 100 people did quit. But I think it's also one of those things where if you've seen the film, you're like, oh yeah, I could see, I could see 100 people working on 100 different people working on this, you know.
I looked at the report and I read through it and I thought, like, this is one of those situations where I don't, like, I'm not for anybody being like overworked at all, like, right? Never. So I feel like when I read about like 11 hour days for 7 days a week, I was like, well, that's not okay. Like, there should have been like one. I'm pretty sure there should have been like one day off, or like, don't you get a Sunday? You know, stuff like that. Like, you probably could have, everybody could have went home on Sunday, you know, like, then that's 52 Sundays, and that means it's gonna take 52 more days for the movie to come out. And it's like, I get it, you know, I'm okay with it being delayed so that it can look like that, but that everyone else cannot feel like they're dying. There's a balance. Because part of the report was like, oh, you know, Lord was really hands-on, but he didn't have the ability to visualize things
in 3D. He would have to like put things on hold, right? Certain elements or certain plot points.
He would have people like animate things entirely, bring it to him, and then they'll be like, well, this isn't right. I need this, this, and this. So now they have to go back and change the whole made animation, and that makes it even harder. So they're like, why? This is so hard. That stuff, I'm like, you know, I don't feel like, I'm sorry, it's hard, I guess. Like, that's that's what you wanted. But the extended hours and all that extra illegal shit, you know, like that stuff needs to be dealt with. But that the actual work being difficult, like, I don't Sorry, I mean, yeah.
I get what you mean. It's weird, you know. There should be some sort of visual effects union of sorts. Like there should be some overarching. Yeah, that's true. There should be some sort of overarching authority, you know, that watches over this industry, because they're always going to get it on the cheap. They're always going to get the cheapest people to do it, and the technology is emerging so fast that people are able to do it at like the prosumer level, like at home, you know. Some people are able to make their own animation even if it's 2D and stuff. So it's like this does take, like, you watch these things, they are a labor of love. And I think one of the other things that's a shame is that while there is 100 people who felt that they were overworked, there's certain people that actually are proud of the work that they've done on this. Yeah. And they've been talking, and they've been kind of getting shut down as like bootlickers, and
that's kind of fucked up, though. You know,
I think so.
That's really messed up. That's the part of today's culture that is like the dark side of the good thing they're trying to do. Sometimes, like, you know, sometimes you people get caught up in the sanctimony of it all. Like, I feel good. This in
absolutes,
feels great.
In absolutes too. Like, you can't be on the right side of everything all the time. That's just not how it's gonna. It's just not how it's gonna work. It's not how humans work. But you know, that's neither here nor there. We know definitely, like, come on, like, I just feel like Amy is not the one to talk to about all this kind of stuff. I don't think she's ever said anything that's,
especially if they told her this, people, though. Like, if this is the information they presented her with, and they're like, Amy, your workers say they're overworked because they keep having to go back and change the thing, and she's like, what? Like, what? Like, why, bro, are you telling me this? Like, welcome to Hollywood, I guess.
Bro, it's the deal with it meme. Right, like, literally, she's watching the numbers climb on this film. I still say that the combination of Spider-Man PS5 and Across the Spider-Verse revitalized Sony's confidence in all of this.
Oh, you know? No, she felt big. She left everything, but like, she's still only on Spider-Man.
That's what I'm saying. Like, she's like, I got this, and you guys are tired. Is that what you guys are telling me? You're tired. We've only just begun. Like, she's something else. And even though we know we're getting beyond the Spider-Verse, F's in the chat for El Muerto. Seemingly, I know this has broken your heart. But Sony Pictures said Wednesday that it has removed the release date schedule from its release date schedule, El Muerto, the Bad Bunny starring Spider-Man movie.
You know, I will say that as stupid as it is, I think that all of these Spider-Man-less villain movies are just the shits. I don't care if it's Venom or Morbius. Like, I don't care. Like, I think they are the shits. I think the whole concept is the shits. Yeah. But I was at least slightly interested in seeing why they had Bad Bunny of all people. Like, what was the idea? Like, what were you thinking?
Yeah, we've seen that he's a great crossover artist. Yeah. He's recently done professional wrestling stuff. He was in Bullet Train. I think he did a fine job in that.
He had like two lines though, but like, he had a long scene. Like, he was in it for like 15 minutes.
He's got good facials between that and pro wrestling. He knows how to put a good face on, and sometimes that's all he needs.
But yeah, I guess he was gonna be like a superpowered luchador or something.
I guess. I feel like you could make that movie without Spider-Man. Like, not like without the Spider-Man universe in general.
I was okay when they said they canceled it without him. Like, he's gonna be like, they canceled it because he was leaving, and I thought that's what was happening, but they're still making it.
So yeah, like, oh, it's just off the schedule because I guess they thought they had a guaranteed release date when they knew he was still a part of it.
Yeah, it's gone.
Right, and the idea is also that I'm assuming the idea is that these films will only work with strong leads. Like, that's why you're going to the theater. You're going to the theater because you recognize Aaron Taylor Johnson. You're going to the theater because you know Jared Leto, because you think Tom Hardy's cool, kind of stuff. But I was
just like that.
I was already like, often joke about the projects that are greenlit by DC, like the characters and stuff like that, and sometimes we'll be like, why that person? But no one's done that more than Sony. Like, everything that they announce, I'm like, but why? Who said that? Who? I want it to be revealed that they're using AI, that they're doing some sort of weird fucking AI thing.
Making up like projects.
Latino villain Spider-Man. And then they're like,
El Muerto.
We're doing that.
El Muerto would be a good choice.
Get Benito.
Please give me love. I want to feel love.
Why did you program me to feel pain? Shut up, you. Keep working. Yeah, so come on. Is what I gotta say about that. that's
basically there were rumors they were looking for like wrestlers that they can get on the movie and everything. There was like Mercedes Moné, Sasha Banks.
Ah, that would have been really cool. You gotta link up with Conan. He knows all the
the hey, yo, I got this guy, Alberto Patron.
Oh no. He's your Alberto right there. There you go. He wanted a fucking villain. Use his ass. So you're telling me you're not excited for the Sony Universe of Marvel characters even after the release of the Red Band trailer? Kraven the Hunter?
Kraven is messed up because I was like, okay, well, maybe. And then they show you the trailer and it's like, nah, I was right. It's like when you dip my toe in to see if it's hot and it's really hot. It burned, actually. Ow, never mind. Yeah. Not swimming in there.
I haven't had such a visceral reaction possibly since seeing the Gotham Knights trailer where I was just like, what? Because I say this ad nauseum. You don't have to make it up. You don't have to. It's already been written. It's already been there. The formula to make the cake is there. And they keep saying, I know it says eggs, but what about eggplants? It's like, no, do it how the recipe says. And they have a moment in here that was just so Sony. When the blood goes in the blood, when the tiger blood, I think, goes inside the wound of Kraven and you go into the DNA. They love DNA and they love eyes, right? The eyes tell you they got powers.
They got a hard drive full of DNA CGIs.
That's what it
is. Ready to go. Like, we got molecules, atoms, you name it. We love it.
They bought all the openers for the X-Men movies where they would just go through the DNA for fucking 20 minutes.
Oh,
my gosh.
No, you know what it is about these villain movies? It they feel so dated, right? It feels like it comes from a time where you weren't allowed to mention this guy in this place. And it's like, so much more open now and everything is so much more like they all touch each other and everything. It's like, how are you going to expect me to watch a movie where we're trying to work around the fact that you don't got Spider-Man in it? Like, it's a Venom movie and like the whole thing just screams like 2009 to me. Like, I don't want anything to do with it.
Yeah. I was even thinking, you know, they were talking about they greenlit or, you know, they're thinking or it's in development, a Spider-Gwen solo animated film, right? And at first I was like, oh, yeah. But then I realized the most interesting parts of Spider-Gwen's universe are the Marvel characters that are not in the same positions. But if they're not in the film because they're not owned by Sony, what is this film going to be? What the hell?
Yeah, yep.
What, and I didn't think about it that way, and I was like, all right, but we're just gonna have to deal with the world without El Muerto, I guess. This is the
but it could have been so cool. You see, at the wrestling match, he could have walked past Spider-Man when he first became Spider-Man, but you only see the back of his homemade costume.
fuck
you.
He's like, wait, I gotta fight that guy for $300, and then
crap. That's what's his name. The human spider or something like that.
Could you imagine the emotional scenes Bad Bunny would have had to done when his Uncle Ben gets killed? When his Uncle Benito gets killed, bro? That's gonna be some rough stuff, bro. I would have seen
Uncle
that.
Benito, aye.
He would have done he would have done the whole soundtrack too. That would have been fire. That would have been so cool. You guys missed out. Go grab Marvel or the rest of Marvel. So yeah, I don't think this feels like one of those things. This guy, first of all, is incredibly busy, right? Like, he's the number one streaming artist, I want to say, in the world right now. He wrestles whenever he's free, and now, you know, he's trying to break into Hollywood, and I can totally see him being like, well, if y'all not ready for this, then I'm out.
Listen, he's got Kendall Jenner. He's not worried about nothing.
Yeah, he ain't worried about nothing. But we have heard that even though El Muerto won't be coming back, that there might be some pretty interesting people that come back for Deadpool 3. Now, recently, we, in our, you know, off air, were privy to some plot details that may have leaked. They could have been right. They could have been wrong. But the big piece of news that happened this week was that people were saying that they spotted Ben Affleck on the set of Deadpool 3. Earlier this year, you heard rumors of the like original X-Men actors, some of the original X-Men actors being a part of this. Does Ben Affleck doing Daredevil, does that excite you? Are you down for that?
No, I think, and it's nothing like, obviously, you know, people feel how they feel about the movie. I think using the multiverse to do cameos is like the cheapest way to use the multiverse. Like, I feel like if you're going to do something with the cameos, then fine. Like, if you're going to do a multiverse story where the Daredevils meet and they have to solve something together, you know, fine.
Yeah.
But this 5-minute stuff, it's kind of killing me. Like, because it's making everybody else have these wrong ideas about the multiverse. And I feel like I love the multiverse. I love to see the way they use the multiverse. Like, stuff like the way they did it in Invincible, like, the way, hopefully they adapt that. Because that's the way to use the multiverse, you know? Like, you can do character stories on a wide scale like that. I think Everything Everywhere All at Once was a big, it was a big version of that. People should have been taking inspiration from there.
Or even Spider-Verse in a way, like the reason why Spider-Verse works, both the book and the film, is because it deals with some of the most outlandish versions. Like, could you imagine a version of Spider-Man like this? More so than, do you remember this?
You know? And it's the heart, though. It's always the heart. It's the character of the heart that's going to shine.
Yeah.
On top of all this bombastic, look at this, we got Patrick Stewart as every version of himself that he's ever played in any movie ever, like,
right,
that's cool too, but not by itself.
So using your canine senses, are you sniffing a lack of heart in this?
No, it just reminded me of everything,
because this quite possibly could just be a parade of cameos. Like, if they're not allowed to do anything structurally, right? Because Deadpool's in a very weird position right now. So are like other X-Men and stuff. I could totally see this being like a weird bottle, non-sequential thing, you know, like where they deal with their own stuff, but they're in their own pocket universe, kind of stuff. And I wonder if taking it to that level of stakes, because Deadpool 1, I think, works because it was so small.
Yeah.
But I also argue that I wanted to see him up, you know, like teaming up with some certain other people. So
also think you can use Deadpool to just shit on the whole genre. Like, you can do your commentary on it if you want. That's what I think. That's what my senses tell me it would be, if anything.
But you could also use it to redeem people and redeem actors and redeem, like, we've seen some of the stuff you know, in The Flash with some of those cameos towards the end, that, you know, some deep cut stuff to redeem certain actors. I could totally see that being done here. An actor that doesn't need redemption that will be in this is Wolverine. That was one of the big selling points about this, is it's supposed to be a Deadpool Wolverine almost kind of buddy movie. But one person that is not too happy about that is James Mangold, the director of Logan. He said, "I can't say that there's a part of me that doesn't wish we let it be. There's always going to be another Wolverine. There could be a baby Wolverine, a cartoon Wolverine. As much liquid as they can squeeze out of that rag, they're going to try to. I don't measure my success on a movie like Logan on whether we ended the conversation. I ended my conversation."
Yeah, he didn't even have a conversation. It was one movie, my guy.
No,
it's all right.
Yeah.
It's okay.
Yeah, you finished everyone else's conversation. Yeah. It was like a 9-movie conversation, and you.
I don't know. I get. I mean, this is my thing. This is why I get weird when the directors start touching all the regular comic characters. Like, you're not there first. you are the 100th guy, okay? Like, you are, yeah, you are on an assembly line. Like, I know you feel a certain way. I get it. You're proud of your work. Yeah. It's yours. But, like, to ever expect, to even have feelings about it, like, you fucking get out of here. Like, that's on you. Like, yeah. I can't feel bad.
And I could understand if you were like trying to stand passionately behind your original work. Oh man, Logan. but if it wasn't wholly original, it just feels like a weird stance to make. If anything, I'd be the cocky guy being like, well, you got to beat that or else people are going to say, nope, it ended at Logan. You know, like, you know, people will go back and be like, no, yeah, my Wolverine ended at Logan. I would be cocky and be like, we did a great job with Logan ending that story. You know, the next director is going to have to do a great job if they want to, you know, continue that legacy. But yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't agree with that, with feeling anything about it at all. It's like, unless, even if, I mean, if you created it, you know, I guess I can understand why you would feel that way at least, but yeah, come on, dude.
Come on. You think you're ready for a new Logan?
I think I was ready to move on from Hugh Jackman. I feel like I was also done with that version of Logan. I would have liked to just cut ties and start fresh, but I guess we're going to have Hugh Jackman one more time. That's so weird.
I think it's going to be the last bite of the apple. I didn't think he would have this many, to be honest. Like I said in previous podcasts, I thought the easy thing to do would be to reveal Logan as another actor in the one where they go back in time and they meet him in the Weapon X suit.
Yeah.
If he would have just been another actor there, they would have just set the standard. Now all that would have been doomed because, you know, it eventually, that whole universe ended up collapsing. But yeah, you know, they totally could have went that way if they wanted to. But yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I think that for the most part, all those movies have a bit of nostalgia factor, or those Fox movies, those X-Men films and stuff. And it's going to be a very, this is all a puzzle. Like, as they're working on putting this puzzle together, like I said, there's stuff going on with Jonathan Majors, there's stuff going on with the writers, there's you know, they're trying to film like two shows I think right now simultaneously while people are beefing with them for the AI art. So there's a lot of spinning plates going on at Marvel, so I'm not too fussed. I think they'll figure it out. But on top of all of that, talking about Fox properties, seems like they still haven't quite nailed, or at least been able to announce, their Fantastic Four cast. This was also supposedly one of the reasons, or a rumored reason, why they didn't do Hall H, was that this would have been the big announcement. Now again, that's all just a rumor.
I think this rumor was big enough that I feel like every person who usually has rumors kind of agreed on it. I was like, okay, I kind of feel like there was a little bit of smoke where the fire was. I feel the heat. I think they did have all these people tied down, and I do think there was a money issue. Like, I believe that 100%.
Yeah, they started to nail down that the idea would be that, or the reported cast was going to be Adam Driver as Reed Richards, Margot Robbie as Sue Storm, Paul Mescal as Johnny Storm, and David Diggs as Ben Grimm. More and more people started to announce this. It felt like it was getting closer and closer, and then all of a sudden reports started to come out that like things fell through, basically. And the big rumor cited is money, that some of these actors weren't too happy with the offers that were put on their table. Where do you sit on this? Like, where do you... are you for the actors on this? Are these actors worth that money? Can this property be done cheaper with newer actors? Should it be ethically done cheaper with newer actors? Or do we owe the first family, you know, a cast that can handle, or at least push it into a brighter new direction? What do you think about all this?
I don't think there's anything wrong with trying to go cheaper. Like, it's not like they're suffering. Like, these aren't suffering artists. Okay, like, the issue is we cost too much. Well, then actually, it's probably more ethical to get somebody who needs the money, I guess. Like, you have too much then, I guess. Like, if you cost that much, you're worth a lot. And maybe we should put some of that budget towards our fucking CGI. Or put it, give it to the artists who are starving.
Yeah. Like, I mean, for the most part, that's what's going to do with the thing.
Right. I think that with the Fantastic Four, I think because it's four people, I think you need one veteran artist or actor with a name. I don't want it to be such a big name that it overshadows the movie, though. Like, I feel like Margot Robbie and Adam Driver, like, we're just gonna throw all these huge Oscar names on this thing. It's huge. I'll never see Reed Richards. I'll always see like Adam Driver. He's Kylo Ren or whatever.
I mean, not only huge actors, but two actors that were stars of huge franchises.
Yeah,
that everyone saw. Yeah, that everyone saw. So it's like, you know, they're capable, but they're not the only ones capable, I guess, is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Hey, Emma Mackey's free. We'll get to that. But Emma Mackey's free if you want. Emma Mackey's free. Nicholas Holt is free. We got a couple people. We got a couple people who are free. We'll get to that in a bit.
You know, I'd really like, I'm still stuck on Glenn Howerton as like, I'll never get over that.
Yeah.
That thing, that's like the perfect read to me, and nobody sees it, I guess. I don't know.
It is. Because of the implication.
He's got the fucking,
even Dennis has the weird sinister, like he uses all his knowledge for evil.
It's so Reed. It's like evil Reed. It is. If he was smart, because he kind of dumb, but
he could be the maker. Yeah, he could be the maker.
Man, he's got that rectangle head. Like,
yes, he does. He has the perfect rectangle head. Yep. You could just see the grays on him. Are you pouring anything out for Krasinski? I saw a post today talking about, like, you know, people being still really bummed at the idea that was that with that actor.
I don't think he was I didn't think it was gonna happen. And then when he did it as like a cute cameo, like, that made me think even more like it's not gonna happen. But since it did happen, I'm glad he was like, he was my Reed from my books.
Yes.
From my Hickman books.
There's a Superman cameo. There's several Superman cameos, but there's a Superman cameo that I won't spoil still, because apparently, given the box office, no one's watching The Flash. So, but there's a Superman cameo in it from a Superman that we've not seen before done in live action. I don't think by including that, they were telling us that was going to happen. You know,
yeah.
I don't think that was confirmation that we're getting that solo project. The same way, I don't think them bending the knee for a fan cast is confirmation that that's exactly what that is.
Yeah, I mean, I also don't really have any issue with like using a fan cast as an inspiration.
Yeah,
you know, Ahsoka as Rosario Dawson is the big one.
could you see someone like Krasinski doing it long term?
I mean, what's he doing now? Just the quiet place?
The quieter place. Even quiet. Even more quiet.
Like, he's not that busy. Like, come on, dude.
No, I think he's like Jack Reacher or Jack Ryan or Jack.
Yeah, he's got one of those Amazon shows.
He's one of those Jacks, bro. Jack of all trades. And you know, like, it was just so easy. Also, that people were just like, oh yeah, him and Emily Blunt, like, they come as a package deal. Like, just do that. Yeah,
I feel like they were both too big too, but I mean, what else are they doing right now too? Like, I mean, what's Emily Blunt's big IP thing? Does she have one?
I don't know. And you know what's funny? Now that you say that, it doesn't even seem like if you are a bomb ass actor or even one in was demand. There's not much to sink. There's not much to sink. But I'm saying in general, like, there's not much to sink your teeth into right now, right? Besides, like, you gotta hope like Nolan's doing a film or Scorsese's doing something.
Oh, so they can put you in their what's the word? God, I was gonna say Rolodex? Entourage movie. No, it's a Fuck. The words on the tip of my tongue. Yeah,
isn't that what it is?
No, it's God, there's another word.
Ensemble
film. There you go. Everything is an ensemble film now. Every yes. actor in the background is a.
The IP is that Oscar winner. These actors are in it.
Yeah, like that's the opposite side of the spectrum. That's the that's to jingle the keys at the cinema snob. Hey, yeah. Look who's in here.
Right.
My favorite underutilized artist.
It's that guy from that show. Who does that thing? I say that because another trailer came out. I can't even remember the name of the film. You've seen the new trailer to the Gal Gadot, like Netflix, something or other, have you?
I can't say I was very interested.
It's not great. And no. It just reminds me of, like, I feel like her and the IMAS are in a very weird position right now where they're trying to work and there's not a lot of stuff. And so they're just kind of signing up. I mean, we're still making like Jennifer Lopez action movies. Like, what are we?
I feel like they, you know what? The thing about the Gal Gadot thing is that, like, it feels like a Gal Gadot project. Like, these are the kind of things that she does. Like, yeah. Little shitty, shitty little side. Because it makes me passionate.
You watch your mouth about Red Notice.
I feel passionate about Red Notice.
Somebody posted up that scene of Superman beating up everybody in Justice League. And I'm just like, gosh, man. Like, just fucking like the direction. Some of that stuff in Justice League, like the way it was portrayed in Justice League, is with the mouth, with the cat, all that stuff. So you've never called him Kal-El. You've literally never called that man that in his life. No, please. He doesn't understand. We get it. We can see.
And I know he thought that shit was she understands that he's not really Clark right now. So she's going to call him Kal-El. It's very subtle.
And then you have Barry doing the Pet Cemetery stuff. And I'm like, wow, this movie, man, this movie was something. You would think, especially with movies like Justice League, that the Gal Gadot would be ready to kind of put this whole universe behind them. But one of the news reports was like, Gal Gadot is fine, that she doesn't need Wonder Woman, guys, look, this is what she said. And then you know, and it's like, yeah, you know, I'm excited to look at, you know, other ventures and stuff. And then like 2 days later it was like, oh, they sat down with Gal Gadot and like, if you want to be Wonder Woman, that's cool too. So she might still be Wonder Woman.
I would like it if she wasn't. I kind of want them to get rid of all of the people from the Snyderverse. Like, why are we still, what are we doing with that?
You think more so because it's jarring? Like, people just remember them for what they...
It's jarring and it's got a bad smell. You know, like, yeah, you're contaminating the new fucking stuff. Get it out. You fucked it up already. Like, you spoiled this. Like, you left it out. Yeah, throw it away. It's done. You finished it. You put Barry in his own little corner there. You've established that Aquaman is with him. Mm-hmm. And finish that and never do it again. Jason Momoa as Lobo, fine. You want to cast Gal Gadot as someone else? You know, that's fine too. But that's got to die.
And DC's usually a lot more ruthless than that. Like, DC's usually a lot more. Like, I remember them talking about the Batman Forever thing. It's like Tim Burton shows up to the studio with a script and they're like, oh yeah, we're not gonna need your script. And he's like, oh, so somebody else writing the script? And everyone's just like, we're not using you at all. Like at the meeting, he tells his ass, like, oh, by the way, yeah, we're not.
History will look back on this day.
think about Wonder Woman 3, right? They were talking about like that was like she was writing it or excited about it, and they were talking about the new directions and stuff that's gonna go on, and then they took everything from Patty Jenkins. They were like, you know what, we're not, you're not,
you know,
doing
you
that.
Know she got dragged out of the building by security.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. So yeah, seemingly she's sticking around. I still believe that the universe in which the Flash take place ends, I guess. I just can see the next movie just like showing that world, zooming out, and then going to another world.
Oh my god.
You know what I'm saying? And then like everything in the DCU, James Gunn's DCU, is on this earth with Blue Beetle and all that other stuff, and we'll just go, maybe we'll come back to where the Flash left off and George Clooney and stuff. But Yeah.
Superman has to open with a big CGI crawl, like showing a, you know, the multiverse. Yes. It's a large place with many super people. You know, like,
but like the first, like the title is huge. It's like, it's all dead. That's what it's going to say when it comes up. It's like, it's all gone. This is where we're starting from now. Don't ask any questions. Just watch the film. And we're taking the post credits out. So deal with that. They, like I said, even with these properties, even with trying to keep all this universe intact, there's no surefire way. Batman vs. Superman 2 marquee names did not make what they thought it was going to make. It still made a lot of money, but didn't break a billion. And I would think, you know, Batman himself by himself has broken a billion. So you would think that those two properties would have been able to. And in a world where you can't have a surefire hit, seemingly Warner Brothers is trying to use AI to greenlight movies so that this could happen. Now, something very interesting happened. It was like a three-step reveal, or yeah, three-step reveal. So the first reveal was this, right? This was an article or whatever that came out this week, this idea that Warner Brothers is going to be using AI, right? To greenlight some films, due to like marketability, popularity, stuff like that. So like that news came out and I was like, oh, that sucks, right? And then somebody had put it to me like this. They're like, that's the entire plot of Space Jam, like a new legacy is this idea that they've built an algorithm that's just going to smash IPs together in the hopes of making a bunch of money. So I thought that was funny. But in trying to research this for this podcast, I found an article that says Warner Brothers signs a deal for AI-driven film management system. Warner Brothers has signed a deal with Cinelict to use the latter's AI-driven project management system that was launched last year. What's ironic about this article is that this article is dated January 8th, 2020.
Yeah.
So
that's not even new information. That's just people's strumming up old stuff.
Right. And old stuff in the height of this paranoia about AI.
That's how the media works, baby.
And so what's also like, let me see something real quick. Like, so the Space Jam New Legacy comes out in 2021. You know, so they sign a deal for this in 2020, then outwardly make fun of it in 2021, which doesn't excuse it. It's actually very similar to what they did in the fourth Matrix movie, where they're like, we could just make this without you kind of stuff. Like when they were being like very meta about like just green lighting sequels and not caring about the subject matter or the stars and stuff. Seems like Warner Brothers is like saying the quiet parts loud, but not really supposed to, about all this AI stuff. That coupled with the fact that they're seemingly selling chunks of their audio library.
That's like so wholesale, weird. They're wholesale. So desperate for money right now. It's so sad.
Is it that Zaslav was given some sort of like mandate about a certain amount of money he had to cut?
I don't know if he was given a mandate as much as he actually made the decision and said it out loud, and he'd be publicly embarrassed if he did not do those things.
It's one of those. From where?
Yeah, no, we're gonna get it. I don't care if I gotta get it from you specifically. What is that horrid smell?
Yeah, right.
Oh, is that a Batgirl movie?
Oh no. That's been killing me, because they've been putting out the directors have been putting out set photos, because they're like, it's dead, so it is what it is. And you know, Keaton looks like he was having a lot of fun, but, you know, who the heck knows.
He was having fun, and then they ruined it the way they did it to Affleck, and Affleck's like, I told you. They suck.
Affleck's hands him a cigarette in the hallway. He's saying, you good? Yeah, I guess I'm good. All right, man. Now we rebuild.
you wanna come do a movie about some urban children or something? I don't know.
We got our first look at Johnny Cage. I was gonna say Keith Urban, Kyle Urban.
Keith Urban is Johnny Cage.
Keith Urban.
Whoa. Wow.
Right? Carl Urban as Johnny Cage. Looks fine, man. I really excited myself up way too much about The Miz. That's basically
that was to never gonna happen. Like, have you seen his Marines?
Yeah, but like, that's the level of acting that would have required. I didn't need him to cry on camera, right? He could have been a C-list.
They're just like, star. Hey, we paid a little bit too much, a little bit. Like, yeah. We already have Cole Young, and we kind of committed to
fucking
him.
Cole Young, son of a bitch. His gold sweater. You know how much his gold sweater takes to make?
I'm sure he's going to be like Scorpion's grandson or something, right?
Ridiculous. What do you think of Frosted Tips, Carl Urban as Johnny Cage?
I mean, I don't know what direction they're taking this thing in. I just know they're like supposed to be setting up the actual tournament in the second one. So he's a big name. Is there anybody else as big as him in these movies?
I wouldn't say so. And I don't say that slighting anybody. Ludi Lin?
I don't know who that is.
He was in Power Rangers. Was he in Fast and the Furious? I know he's in...
I might know him by picture, but I certainly don't know that name.
He's a Liu Kang.
Okay.
Yeah, he's their Liu Kang. And then Macad Brooks from Supergirl is in there as Jax. I wouldn't.
Oh, that's
say
right. He's not.
Yeah, I wouldn't necessarily say he's bigger than Carl Urban. But yeah, that I guess that's why it felt weird. Like none of these people, to my knowledge, were huge box office stars.
They're like,
He would be the biggest, and he's not even playing like the franchise. The biggest person in the franchise, so that feels kind of weird.
I'm here to die.
and they already got a Kano. He could have just been Kano. I do like their Kano though. That's pretty good. Yeah, I hope it does well, because we're living in a world where, like I said, things are not going so well for films. The biggest thing being, you see it, I feel like every headline, that The Flash seemingly is doing worse and worse, and it's possibly just going to be an overall money sink for DC. How do you feel about this? Is this a downward trend, or is this specifically for The Flash, given, like we said again,
people feel like about this,
Ezra Miller?
This strong reaction was probably towards the Ezra Miller thing, the boasting about how good the movie was. There's a lot of factors, and I feel like James Gunn's Superman is gonna do a lot better than the freaking Flash. I don't know if Blue Beetle is gonna do anything. I don't have high hopes for Blue Beetle. I don't have high hopes for Aquaman. I don't particularly care to see Aquaman.
Yeah.
But I know I want to see that James Gunn Superman movie. I mean, that's where I'm at. Like, I am beyond. Like, and I know the studio can't. There's no way. Like, I know they thought this was their guaranteed hit. But I would hate to see them take it out on what is yet to come. You know, like, I'm sure David Zaslav is not happy with what happened to The Flash, but I would hate to see him take it out on, like, all of DC.
I think we're right to be fearful of that, because we've seen studios take the wrong message when it comes to stuff like this.
Yeah, I think, though, I do think that means that maybe James Gunn only has one shot at this. He's got... one shot. He's gonna swing as hard as he can with that Superman movie. I'm saying, put your Thanos smile at the end of that bitch or something like that. Look, everyone in like, the universe.
I feel like, and obviously this is hyperbole, right? But it's like if I went into a museum and I saw like one of Hitler's best paintings, and I'm like, I can't argue. That's pretty good art. I couldn't make that shit, but. Sucks, you know, like the rest that comes with this kind of sucks. And it's like The Flash is inarguably, in my opinion, a good film. Structurally, if you have problems with it visually, if you have problems with it personally, I can see it. But I think structurally, given all that we've taken in from the DCEU, it's competently made, and I don't think it deserves to be drugged this way. But like you said, there's too many outside factors, not only affecting moviegoers, but comic book moviegoers, and then people who are trying to distinguish where to use their money. Spider-Verse just came out, right? So it's like, what are we going to go see? Oh, I type in The Flash, and all I get is, you know, Flash star Ezra Miller, you know, arrested in Hawaii or whatever, that, you know, that kind of stuff can deter you. I can't help but feel like Blue Beetle and Aquaman 2 are dead in the water. I can't shake that feeling. And it's because I don't know how you could drum up more excitement from the well. I feel like the well is kind of dry right now. And I don't know if Blue Beetle is going to have enough of what it takes to get over that line. And the cast looks fine. The graphics look amazing. Warner Brothers never cheaps out on the CGI. They may rush it, but they don't. I don't think they cheap out on it. I just kind of feel bad. And like you said about Aquaman, who cares? Like,
yeah,
who I laugh cares?
They shot a cameo with Affleck. They shot a cameo with Keaton. And none of those things are going to be in the movie. Nobody knows what this thing's going to be. Nobody cares. It's certainly not going to make as much as the first one, which I still don't know how that happened.
And the first big piece of like press, or the first big thing that got everyone talking about Aquaman 2 was Amber Heard and whether or not she was going to stay on, given on everything that was going on there. So it's like, this is where we're at now.
I forgot they spoiled half that movie in court.
Yeah. Like, she's not even going to be in it. We're sending her to another planet.
And she gets blown up in the beginning.
She gets torn apart by piranhas in the very beginning. They weren't supposed to turn. It sucks. I don't see this movie making its money back. But, you know, I do like that they are allowing Andy Muschietti to do Brave and the Bold. Now, you're a huge Batman fan. It seems like they are doing some uncharted territory with the character. They're having their cake and eating it too, right? Because I think they're going to play it semi-safe with the Batman. You know, he'll do kind of Batman by numbers. And I think they're going to kind of do some experimentation with this Batman Brave and the Bold. How do you feel about Muschietti leading it, directing it, given what you saw and possibly what you liked about The Flash?
I think... I feel like what I saw out of him from The Flash, I don't really see. I don't think he was there to do the kind of thing he could do on a Batman movie. I feel like his horror, he can really let out his horror side on a Batman film. But then I consider, what kind of Batman film is it going to be? Right? Because you already have the quote unquote epic crime drama.
Yes.
You know, the Matt Reeves stuff. And then this movie that's supposed to have the Bat family in it.
Right.
It's like based on it's based on Grant Morrison's Batman and Robin. So I'm like, you know, are we going to kill Bruce Wayne?
Yeah, I'm about to say, give me Over the Edge, you cowards. Give me that episode where they gas Batgirl. Oh, is it Batgirl? Yeah,
Batman.
Gas Babs. And,
Babs, yeah. I always thought it was weird because she sees herself die.
Yes, she does.
Such a weird dream.
Bro, that's the most metal thing to ever happen in Batman animation. It's fucking James Gordon driving and his daughter's body dropping from the sky and landing on his car. Like, that's so crazy. And then I always knew you better run. I was like, it's one of the greatest things ever. I want that level of emotional investment, you know, where when Alfred quits in Dark Knight, Dark Knight Rises. Like, I want that level of investment in this. They're going to need a good Batman. They're going to need a good Robin. Muschietti seems to know family stuff. I don't know how much of that, you know, son and mother stuff was him. But that was all throughout The Flash. They had some jokes and stuff, so I could see them going there. Batman's in the film, and the actor seemingly had more fun than he did in any other iteration, so he at least knows how to make actors feel comfortable and welcome and get the best out of them. So I'm excited about that. And I'm also excited that Gotham Knights was canceled. And I do not feel bad for saying that. I felt
like this cost $10 to make and we still don't want to do it.
Again, who is that for? this feels the series feels like a series that would be pitched on a parody show like The Boys. you know. Well, like, you know Batman, you know his life, and yeah, sure, you know his Bat family, but what about his Bat family in 2023? You know, like,
it's like something out of Teen Titans Go, like a fake movie, like the Batmobile movie.
And it's like, we're not doing any other albums. No, you know that those stories we've made up, people who didn't exist, or we took people like Kathy Kelly and just, gosh, just what a. What a shit show.
Beautiful, beautiful people in this horrible, horrible show.
Yeah, in this horrible, horrible world. But Gotham Knights is gone, which I think that there's no Bat stuff on TV, right? I'm looking left, I'm looking right. Have we gotten rid of all the tangential Batman stuff?
They still have for the kids the Bat Wheels show with the Bat Wheels.
Pennyworth is done.
Pennyworth died, yeah.
Gotham is gone. Gotham Knights is gone, and Batwoman is gone. I think those, and Titans is seemingly done.
It is. It's done. It's done. They're done.
That's a lot of
Penguin.
There's no Batman in here. Stuff. That's a lot of there's no Batman in here. Properties.
I want Penguin coming.
Well. I do want Penguin to do well.
Does that rumor that Batman can actually be in it? So weird.
Oh, that's cool.
That's so weird.
So yeah, the future of Batman is still bright. We got a movie coming up in the future. We know Batman, the Batman 2 is being worked on. We know Joker 2, they're doing something with that. So, you know, Warner Brothers is really going to be looking at those films that have already made them a lot of money to do that again. So hopefully they can recoup on some of these losses. But another DC character that seemingly has a bright future, we have our Superman. Holy hell. David Corenswet?
Corenswet? Corenswet? Sweet. I don't fucking know. Clark Kent.
Yeah. Yes, Clark Kent has been cast. David Corenswet. I hope I'm saying that right. And Rachel Brosnahan. It will be playing Lois Lane. There was a lot of back and forth about, you know, the audition process, chemistry tests, all that kind of stuff. We knew Nicholas Holt was up for it. We knew Emma Mackey was up for it, among others. I actually thought that this was going to take a little bit longer because that was like, that's what, like, people were like, oh, like, they're making them, like, play tag, and they're making them, you know, they're making them bake cookies, and they're making them, James Gunn isn't sure yet. He's making them, you know, do shadow puppets. But apparently they've nailed it. They've got it. Those will be our new Clark Kent and Lois Lane. I announced it via ComicBookClique.com and noticed that we instantly started getting a lot of shares and comments. And I thought people were excited for this news. And while some of them are, I forgot there is a very angry base that is upset at anything not Snyderverse, and particularly a base. And I don't even really blame this base. That was kind of got the rug pulled out from under them because of Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
Yeah.
And they were teased about getting almost something that they
this close.
Yeah, that they. I honestly feel if that didn't happen, I don't think people would have had that big of an idea of it. If you would announce that summer that they were talking about replacing him, you would have got, you know, your hems and haws about it. But definitely what didn't make it work better was the cameo in Black Adam and the subsequent video that he ended up shooting on his Instagram where he's like, I'm so happy to come back, guys. Like, I'm so happy.
There was news that there was going to be a Man of Steel 2.
Yeah. Yep. There was even, you know, even before then, they were talking about Matthew Vaughn doing Man of Steel 2, talking about his world being more colorful. People were super enthusiastic over it. And then, so now this, you know, stands in the way of that. But come on, people, you know what this is. Wait long enough and you'll see Cavill return, you know? But comics are about different interpretations of the characters. And I just feel like when different actors play it, it's just different artists on a book. That's why Superman looks different. It's just a different artist. It's the same story, same character that I know. You know, they just draw Metropolis this way, and these people draw Metropolis this way. There's a reason why the Batmobile keeps changing every comic. You know, everyone tries to put their stamp on it. this do you think going this way is good, casting, making sure that the first two people you cast are Lois and Clark?
Yeah, I mean, the DC universe, it's nexus, it's nuclei, the middle of the the center, the heart of the DC universe is Superman.
Yeah,
everything expands from him, you know. Casting Superman first is definitely the way to go. You're building your world around him. He is the DC universe. That is the first, the greatest, you know, how that all goes. I love this choice, though. The Superman in particular, I'm not too certain about Lois. I don't really know anything about her. I didn't watch the Miss Maisel show. I just really like the way this guy looks. It's like, damn, you look like a Superman. People think he looks like Henry Cavill. Some people think he looks like Tom Welling. I'm like, well, both those guys kind of look like Christopher Reeve, and they all look like Superman. So, like, I feel like that's the point.
And maybe it's just the imagery that I've got, but he feels younger than Cavill did when he stepped in the role.
Yeah. Well, Cavill was manly. Like, that's a manly Superman. Like, I miss there was something.
Look at that chin dimple.
About him, like, look at that guy. Look at his fucking chest. Jesus. Yeah. Look at that hair. That's a man.
Watch him build that PC.
Right? He's like sweating.
Yeah, right. And the flight music is going on in the background.
But look at the smile on his face. He's so happy. Baby. Current Sweat definitely has a more boyish charm to him. He looks like a younger, much younger Clark. I mean, shit. Clark was, Cavill's Clark was what, 33?
I want to say.
When we first meet him, because that was the whole.
Jesus.
Yeah.
What am I supposed to say? Jesus.
Yeah.
That line always gets me from Star-Lord. he's so upset. He's so not impressed. if they nail this, man, I was completely unconvinced that Superman was the linchpin for all this kind of stuff before I got super into DC. I've seen them have success without him. I've seen them make movies and animated shows and cartoons, you know, and where he's like a side character, where he's like not like the main focus. And ever since I started my, you know how I feel about Man of Steel, but ever since I started that campaign, that protest over certain things that I felt like mischaracterized him in that film, I've been able to enjoy Superman media more, that I starting to understand the kind of Superman that I want. And I think if they're able to nail this, bro, this could be kind of a turning point for them. Because I don't think that they've been able to nail this 100% in, I mean, it's up to you how many years. How many years you think it's been since, like, they had an absolute, everyone had no issues with what they've done with the Superman property.
Well, I don't know that there's it's Christopher Reeves and then that's it. I don't know that people are ever going to agree on like until they see it. That's why I feel like we need to remove everything. We need to just give people a chance to grieve and move on, and they will eventually. They just need that time. I mean, and like you said, bringing back Cavill just reopened the wound. Now it hurts again. Now nobody wants to hear about a new Superman and then one that looks like Cavill.
They
replaced Cavill with Cavill Light. Like, it's the corny joke.
No, but that reminds me of like every single article where it's like, this studio is looking for, I'm just gonna use Henry Cavill, right? But it's like, this studio is looking for a Henry Cavill type, and it's like, then get Henry Cavill.
And they hired
you know, so and so. They hired Nicholas Holt. It's like, wait, I thought you said you were looking for Henry Cavill. It's always so weird because I remember the whole She-Hulk Alison Brie thing. They're like, oh yeah, we're looking for an Alison Brie type. Yeah. And I'm like, just get Alison Brie. And she's
wow,
there.
You know what? That was kind of an Alison Brie type, wasn't it?
Yeah. You understand what I'm saying? So it's like, that always sucks if someone's playing your type.
I mean, I'm going to the store with a dollar. I'm looking for a Coca-Cola type. I'm looking for something cola that doesn't say Coke on it because right. I only have a dollar.
Yes. So,
yeah, help me out here.
But yeah, I think that it's 2025 is when this film's supposed to come out. So I think by then enough bad blood, enough time would have passed, the wounds would have been healed, and people will be able to kind of embrace this while other things are going to be announced, while other things are going to be laid out that get people excited for this universe. Interestingly enough, Superman and Lois was also renewed. There was a big discussion about Gotham Knights and Superman and Lois kind of being on the bubble. This idea that they weren't 100% sure whether or not they'd greenlight either show. And to the practical people, they're like, oh, well, if they're going to greenlight a show, they're not going to greenlight the show with the guy that flies and has laser eyes and kind of stuff like that. That doesn't make any sense. It'd be way too expensive. But I guess it makes more sense to them to renew that than to cut or than to renew Gotham Knights. So Superman and Lois is being renewed, but with the caveat that half of its supporting cast will no longer be there. Big news across the board. How do you feel about the renewed Superman and Lois, and do you feel like in any way this neuters the show?
Yes, because the budget thing, like hearing major budget cuts is a big deal. That to me, especially because like I just seen a clip of like the season. I mean, I don't know, was it the season finale or but like a big thing happened on Superman and Lois this
week. Oh, today is the season finale.
Yeah, and I was like, wow, like you can't do that with a lower budget. Like what? The hell?
Like, oh, did it not look good?
Or? No, it looked great. Oh, that was why
you were trying to think of in the future, like if they were ever trying to tackle stuff this big.
Yeah. I was like, well, they won't be able to do this again. So I hope they tie that up. Like, I hope they don't have to use that again. Or I hope the CGI model they created is free to use.
Right.
Streamlining the cast in an effort to funnel money towards the rest of the stuff on the budget is the move. I don't have an issue with that. And to be honest, if you're going to streamline the story like that, you're going to cut it down and maybe focus on like the Kents, you know, alone, you know,
I mean, I think they're going to get trapped in a dimension for a season or space.
And then that's they can just they can move to the middle of nowhere.
They live on the fortress, the summer on the Fortress of Solitude, bro.
There's no background extras. There's no friends, no neighbors.
Superman Lois summer vacation.
What happened to Grandpa? He died.
He's gone. Yeah, Sam Lane is supposedly not going to be on the show anymore. Of the Langs, the Lang family.
They said
the Cushings, the Cortezes. What are they again?
The Cushings. They're the Langs, right?
The Cortezes. No.
Oh gosh. Oh, that's right. We're taking back our name.
Mija.
Mee-haw.
Mee-haw. Yeah, and again, in no way am I like, oh, they got a new Superman and Lois in the film. They're shitting on Tyler Hoechlin and, you know, Bitsy Tulick. It's like, no, again, different strokes, different folks. I really like what they did on this show. I hope there are parts of it that are implemented in the characterization of Superman. And this, because I think largely you want to see Superman and kind of smile. Like he should be someone that kind of brightens the room. I'm not saying that he can't face struggle and stuff like that, but he should be more so inspired. I feel like it's like Spider-Man, you know, like it should be brighter for the most part, with levels kind. Of, yeah, kind.
Kindness in a world that thinks kindness is uncool.
And some would say that that world for many was the Snyderverse. It was the DCEU. I'm not calling it cruel. I'm telling you what other people are saying about it. And I'm saying all that to get into our final news piece, which I think is kind of interesting because initially, before I knew what I was going to do with this episode, I was considering ranking the DCEU films, the 13 films that came out of the DCEU. But we've done a version of that in different ways for different properties. So instead, this article landed on my lap that DCEU is coming out with a box set of movies that are going to be released in 4K. And ironically, the box set is missing three movies. The movies being Birds of Prey, The Suicide Squad, and Suicide Squad. So the 10 films together are Man of Steel, BVS. I just realized that it doesn't have Justice League in this.
It is Justice League.
Is it? They wrote it wrong then. They put...
Yeah.
Okay.
On the cover, you can see it's the Justice League.
It's the colorful people.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so Man of Steel, BVS, Justice League, Wonder Woman, Wonder Woman 2, Aquaman, Shazam, Black Adam, Shazam 2, The Flash. So the question I have for you is, what do you think, what do you omit from your from your 10 film DCEU collection?
I mean, certainly not The Suicide Squad.
So The Suicide Squad goes back in here, goes back in the deck.
Suicide Squad goes in, what's the other one that's missing? Suicide Squad can probably stay out. Birds of Prey can come in. It was fun. It was harmless. It wasn't like torn to shreds by the studio. Like regular Suicide Squad, I would leave in a desert somewhere because it's an embarrassment to yourself. You should feel embarrassed for having let that happen. Like you made that decision.
Is it bad that I like that soundtrack?
I mean, there was nothing wrong with the soundtrack. It's when you chop the freaking movie up to try to
like certain times I'll hear Heathens and I'm like, damn, that movie could have been so much better. I'm like, that really could have been more grungy and more.
It felt like
and Wayne all on his rap song where he's all high and shit. Like they could have done something there. So you're putting in the Suicide Squad, Birds of Prey. You're putting in. What would you take out?
I'm taking out Black Adam. I mean, I would leave Black Adam in because I'm gonna leave the Shazam movies in.
Both.
I feel like I didn't see the second Shazam, so I can't say it was bad. But everybody I know that watched it thinks it was like they think it was pretty good. It just wasn't, you know, anything crazy.
Yeah.
Probably I'd leave Black Adam in, I'd leave Shazam in. I'm thinking of like what I would take out. Justice League for sure, but I mean I at least expected that.
If Justice League you're taking out, then by looking at this list, the only other one that I could see you taking out is Wonder Woman 84.
Oh God, I forgot that was on there. That should have got out first.
You think Wonder Woman 84 is worse than Justice League?
No. I mean, like,
oh, okay.
I just forgot it was there. Like, I wouldn't have struck. Regular Suicide Squad and Wonder Woman 84 were like easy to throw away.
Okay.
Justice League for sure, but at least like that one is like it's been through so like I expect that. I don't understand why the other movies are left out. Zack Snyder's Justice League, I knew, like I didn't even think they would ever acknowledge that again. That was like I was happy to hear about it in The Flash.
Right,
like,
right. Oh, like, yeah.
So that's funny. But if the DC universe is dead, then it would be pretty harmless to throw Zack Snyder's Justice League in there rather than the embarrassment. Especially since Joss Whedon got like kicked out of Hollywood, right? You don't need to put his movie in there.
Right. And you could have took out 84 because it literally changes nothing.
It is nothing. It's a victim.
It changes nothing. Like nothing of what you know of the story, what you know about Diana, nothing. You can just see the first Wonder Woman and then see her in her 78 cameos throughout the rest of the DCEU. Ridiculous. I'm wondering if the Suicide Squad, if Suicide Squad should be more. And I get a lot of hate for knocking Birds of Prey. Maybe I gotta rewatch it. Just felt like the wrong movie for the wrong time.
I just didn't like Cassandra Cain. Otherwise, I thought it was a pretty good movie. I mean, everybody's performance was there. I really liked the Black Canary. I mean,
what do you think about Black Mask?
It wasn't like a. It was an interesting way to go with it. It wasn't like it wasn't anything that spit in my face about everything I know about Black Mask. Like we didn't get to see it, but it's implied that he's similar, you know, similarly ruthless and involved in the same kind of things. Like, you know, the most embarrassing thing was the Cassandra Cain. But ultimately, I think the biggest thing was like it wasn't a Birds of Prey movie. Like, you could have called this Harley Quinn and Friends. You know, like Harley Quinn something. You know, like instead of, you know, Harley
that
Quinn.
That name was kind of also not great. Like, it did not
emancipation of Harley Quinn, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, Birds of Prey and the Fantabulous Emancipation of One Harley Quinn was a hard title to swallow. And then to regulate the team in the that's in the title to supporting characters felt very strange, because majority of those characters in the Birds of Prey have long histories in comics, like way fat past Harley. But they were enamored by Margot's Harley. I don't blame them, but I again they took the wrong lessons.
That's a money thing. They're always gonna go with the money. This is money.
I also think it was her thing, wasn't it? Wasn't it her production company?
Yeah, I mean, they wanted Margot. We want to do a new Harley movie, and I'm sure she's like, "Well, let my production company handle it, and I want this, this, and that, and this, and that."
Yeah,
I live for the.
She still got Tarantino sending her money for feet pics, so she's good. She's good on
I'm
there.
Good for the next, I don't know, however long these feet last before they start getting wrinkles.
That's it. Hey, he pays extra for the wrinkles. Uma won't send them anymore, bro. He's paying, they gotta pay extra. So the one thing I want to say about Birds of Prey that always changed the way that I looked at that movie is that, similar to what we were talking about, the Alison Brie thing. For Black Mass, they were looking for a Sam Rockwell type.
And they went with Ewan McGregor? Okay.
Which was strange, but if you look at the performance, he's kind of doing Sam Rockwell. And now that changed the movie forever for me. Like, when he's looking at the shrunken heads and he's like, ew. You know, like, he's just being like weird and shit. I was like, oh, Justin Hammer, this would have killed. So what we'll do to end this episode out, I have the 13 films in the DC EU. We're putting them all to bed, but before we do, I'd like you to say something nice about all the films in the DC EU. Are you ready?
Oh boy, here we go.
Oh, we'll start easy. Man of Steel.
Iconic. Love that movie.
Batman versus Superman.
Overhated.
Overhated. Justice League.
It reminded me of like a 30-minute episode of Justice League Unlimited. Very shallow, but you know, like,
the most you can get. Yeah, like they're not really trying to dive too deep in a 30-minute like, episode.
Yeah.
Yeah. Suicide Squad.
You had a nice soundtrack. I'll say, like, I also liked that, and it's messed up because it's a deleted scene, but there's a scene of Harley Quinn kind of being a psychologist to her Suicide Squad mates, and I like that they showed that side of her in the movie. That's my good thing to say about it.
You know what I'll say about Suicide Squad, and I said this, I think we did a review of it the other day. I give it credit for that new Harley design. I thought that was a pretty cool Harley design that they made for that. Yeah. Now, obviously, it's like the most iconic.
The most successful thing it did.
Yeah, 100%. But like that, yeah, that you chalk it up to that film. Wonder Woman.
Oh, that's a great movie. I was going to say it pushed the genre forward, but it didn't. But it's still good. It's a great movie.
Yes. Birds of Prey.
The bacon, egg, and cheese scene is incredible.
Yeah, you can respect a good breakfast sandwich.
Oh yeah, no, a bacon, egg, and cheese specifically.
Yeah,
that's if you're gonna put Harley Quinn from Brooklyn, then that, my friends, that's we adaptation. All are. That's adaptation right there.
Hey, there you go. Aquaman.
It's better than it looks from the outside.
So the dive bar.
Yeah, if you actually watch it, you might enjoy yourself.
You'd walk past it just looking at it. But if you come inside, you might have a good time.
Yeah, it's all right. Until Pitbull starts playing on the jukebox, and then it's time to go home. But much like a dive bar.
Ocean to ocean, baby. What a cash grab, man. That was that was the Morbius of songs, because if you remember, it's a cover of Africa at the height of that, when we meme Africa to death.
Yeah.
And again, what a shitty thing for the studio to be like, oh, well, this is the new, not understanding that we're memeing it, but being like, oh no, this is the new popular song. We'll just have Pitbull remake Africa.
That's how you know they were scared of the studio at the time. Nobody fought back on that.
No, not at all. Shazam.
Great. I don't know how people usually feel about that movie, but I thought it was a great film. A great little film.
I thought so too. Black Adam.
Black Adam. It's a good action movie. A great action movie. Great action movie. I'll leave it at that.
I could almost see Black Adam on Netflix under a different title. And I think I almost would have liked it more. But I was kind of upset with the universe kind of stuff. From the promotional material, Shazam Fury of the Gods.
It looks like it could be cute. Rachel Zegler things are usually cute little things.
Yeah, yeah. The Suicide Squad.
Like very more, you know, it's a lot more colorful than you'd think. You know, when you watch that movie, like I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about. I was thinking
The promotional material.
Because then I was like, no, but then the promotional material had that stupid yellow bright poster. So it's like, all right, it's just like it's the movie's like drowned in like gray, and then it's got pops of color that actually make it stick out even more. And I was like, that's pretty cool.
I instantly think of Starro.
Yeah, yeah, or the Harley Quinn flower scene.
Yeah, yeah. And like I said, just for putting Starro in a film, like, come on. Like, they should get all the points for that. And finally, as we lay our Scarlet Speedster to rest, The Flash.
Another movie that's overhated.
Yeah.
Even if it's understandable why.
Yeah, I could definitely see this thing doing better in the future.
It'll stream and it'll become a cult classic.
Yeah. Well, that's it for the DCEU. That's it for this episode here, the Major Issues Podcast. I'm glad we got to talk about a lot of this stuff that's happening, because there is so much stuff currently just up in the air, and these studios get praised for their ability to create a breadcrumb trail, right? Like to lay out whole slates and stuff, but that stuff feels harder and harder to do in this current climate. And you can't change the tire while you're still driving the car. And I don't think any of these companies have the balls to stop for a second. I guess you could argue Disney's kind of doing that with the change in regime and trying to figure out, you know, something about what was it, quality over quantity, which again, I don't think they ever said that, because I don't think that they would admit to that. Do you think this, you could see all this kind of stuff turning around, like this sort of apathy towards some of these films, some of these projects and stuff?
Yeah, I don't think that's any real concrete feeling. Like, it's not like, oh, you know, people talk a lot of game, like, oh, you know, superhero movies, they're failing, blah, blah, blah. And then one comes out and it's a little good, and people are like, yeah, they're back. Superhero movies are great, everything. Like, they're fine. I mean, yeah, eventually I guess they'll go the way of the Western, but maybe they still make Western movies too. So,
yeah, I think similarly, we are people. I know I am, because of what I do here for Major Issues, I'm always on to the next thing. Right.
Yeah.
So, you know, we talk about the superhero fatigue. I'm gorging myself. I can't binge and then be saying like I'm tired of eating, because I don't have to eat to the volume that I'm eating or as much as I'm eating, you know, like, or as fast as I'm eating. I don't have to. I literally don't. So a bit of that pacing is on me, I would say. But like we were having this conversation in the chat, I like this stuff, so none of it really feels laborsome to kind of watch and dissect and stuff like that. But as soon as I'm done doing that, I'm on to the next thing. I say all of that to say that, how long ago does Guardians feel?
Yeah, no, I guess for me it's different because I just saw it.
Oh, yeah.
I just went to the theater.
Yeah. But it to me, it feels like you could have said that movie came out earlier this year.
Yeah.
You know? Just because of how much content then we're on now. Guardians is closing in on $900 million.
But that's it's crazy. I didn't know
it's not making the news. That's what I'm saying. It's not making the news because that's what's meant to happen. You know? And because these successes are not highlighted and as clickbaity as the failures, it may seem like when you look things up, all you see are failures. All you see are problems and controversies and stuff. But that's not what's really showing up in the numbers. Let me see where Guardians is at right now. But yeah, I saw it like in the high 800s. What is that? What the heck is that? Something called Journeys opened up on my Google Chrome. I've never heard of such a thing. No, like I went to the search bar, put Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3, and it said continue your journey. When I clicked on that, a sidebar came out showing like certain things that I Googled for Guardians of the Galaxy.
Kind
of
strange. My God.
831 million dollars it's at right now.
That's beautiful. That's a beautiful thing. I hope it crosses that billion because that's all they seem to care about these days.
But to me, it's like once I'm watching the next comic book movie, I'm almost assuming that the previous one is not even there anymore. But that's not the case. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm just like, oh, yeah. I saw Guardians. I guess it's gone. You know, but no, people are still catching it. People are still watching it. That's what I'm saying. Like, I see this in a whole completely different perspective because I'm usually there on Thursday.
Yeah.
But the common person is going to take their time to watch this movie, is going to eventually watch it when they want to watch it. And if they dig it, they'll take people to see it or they'll watch it multiple times themselves. But I'm always just looking at that first week window because that's my window. That's what I'm in there. So it's like, oh, no one saw it this weekend. I guess no one likes it.
Yeah. Honestly. I mean, shit, I didn't get to see it until 2 weeks ago. I'm there.
You want to get the people side now. You want to get the people a quick review? What'd you think?
Oh, I thought it was great. I thought it was I got to see it after Across the Spider-Verse. I was worried. I was like, oh boy, like this is really good. I hope it lives up. But yeah. I was able to look at it really objectively. I was like, I was not going into this with the first weekend hype and, oh my God, how is this going to end or whatever?
Yeah.
I just kind of watched it like a movie and I was just able to take in like what makes it so good. And it was just that heart, that emotion, like in the middle of everything.
Yeah.
It's that character work, you know, like that right. At the end of that movie, I was like, man, this guy is he's going to make a great Superman film.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
100%. I think it's very similar in many ways to Zack Snyder's Justice League in the sense that you can tell it's one man's vision. You can tell it's one man's love for these characters and an understanding of these characters. I saw Zack Snyder's Justice League and even how I felt about previous films, I'm like, this is a complete vision. And I like this vision, you know, all the dots connecting kind of stuff. And when I saw Guardians 3, I'm like, this is inarguably James Gunn. Like this, he did all this from the first one all the way over here. And I think you put that on the resume for, I could almost guess Guardians is probably going to make more than most of the DCEU films.
Yeah.
And that's crazy because I think it's right now inching on Batman versus Superman, which I believe is like an 861 or something like that. And this is about the tree and the raccoon stuff. So,
But it needed to make more. You see, Batman's name was on it. You know, Batman's name was on the Flash too. And look what you did.
Yeah, look what you did.
I bet you would have been happy with 800 million now, huh? You sick fucks. You deserved every minute of that.
You ruined everything. All that I sacrificed. Yeah, but yeah, you guys, if you guys want to see the future of all this kind of stuff, you just got to keep your ear to the ground, keep your fingers on the pulse. And that's what we try to do each and every week as part of the Major Issues podcast, trying to always talk about the latest and greatest things to come to comic books and comic book media. We are, all of our stuff is available at comicbookclique.com. That's where every episode of the Major Issues podcast currently sits. It's over 287 episodes. That's over 500 hours of content. And we started in 2017. So if a comic book film has come out in 2017, moving forward, you would get our first run reactions for our theater viewings. But we also have gone back and done some retro film watches. We just recently covered Punisher Warzone, which was a film I had never seen before. I think right now, the only Marvel film I have never seen besides like the made for TV, like Punisher and Nick Fury, is Man-Thing. There's a Man-Thing, Wes Craven? I know there's Wes Craven, Swamp Thing. But yeah, one of those films. So there's still things to uncover. There's still opinions to be had. Make sure you're following us wherever podcasts are found. Podbean, Stitcher, Podcast Addict, the Apple Podcast app, TuneFind, YouTube, Spotify. We're all over. You can just Google the Major Issues podcast. We'll pop right up. But yeah, comicbookclique.com is the easy way to find all those episodes. It's also the easiest way to help us and support us monetarily by going to our shop, our TeePublic shop. You can access that from our website. You can also access our Patreon, and for as little as 10 cents a day, $3 a month, you can help us keep our lights on here as we try to afford the hardware and the software to keep providing content free of cost every single week to you guys. So consider doing that. If you can't help us with the Patreon or by buying a piece of merchandise, which we get a kickback for, consider rating and reviewing the podcast on iTunes. Give us 5 stars, help us grow our audience, and help us find those who are looking for the kind of content that we deliver each and every week, this in-depth analysis about all things comic books and comic book media. We're all over our socials. We like talking to the people. Our numbers are growing across social media. It's making me very excited that now I can kind of finally feel like I could be myself.
Yeah.
And joke about things on social media. And some, like before, a lot of the stuff is, when you run a site like this, a lot of stuff is relaying information and stuff, but it's cool to just get some of our opinions out there of the team and see some of that stuff get shared around. So yeah, join us with the future of Comic Book Clique by going to facebook.com/comicbookclique, Instagram @comicbookclique, or using the hashtag comicbookclique to talk about the newest, hottest, latest, and greatest things to come to comic books and comic book media. We're @MajorIssueCBC on Twitter and @MajorIssueCBC on Twitch. I've been kind of ghost on Twitch, but I'm hoping that things in my personal life clear up so I can get back on that horse, but hopefully get back on that horse by the time Spider-Man 2 comes out, which I'm super duper excited for. But I'm not the only one producing content over on this episode. John, tell them what you do.
Hey, so make sure you go over and check out my Dirty Radio podcast. Podcast about professional wrestling, if you're into that kind of thing. And if not, go over to Dirty Radio, the social medias. We cover a whole bunch of stuff over there. Facebook, Dirty Radio, Twitter, Dirty Radio. You can find us on there talking all types of crap.
I'm going to put that also in the episode description so people can go ahead and click and get sent right over there. I'm assuming the next episode is about 5 hours long.
It's a pay-per-view night, baby.
This might be the one to jump in on, guys. You want to talk about a buffet of opinions, dealing with a buffet of content. This is going to be the episode to jump in on. So follow Jonathan Escudero everywhere he's at. Follow Dirt Sheet Radio wherever they're going, because they're going to the moon. And you know, similarly to us, you know, I've been to the future where we are in skyscrapers across the street from each other waving when we become the latest and greatest things to come to our selective pieces of content creation. But I can't tell you how we do it, because if I do that, the next thing you know, $7 Productions buys DC Comics. And you're not going to be happy with what comes out of that whole
scenario. The hierarchy is about to change at Comic Book
Clique. Oh, no. And then I just start floating because I paid too much money at this Comic-Con to not do anything. So I'm just going to float and lightning strikes are going to happen behind me. But my name is George Serrano, a.k.a. The Don.
This is John Escudero, a.k.a. Yogi.
And this is our All the News We've Missed So Far episode of the Major Issues Podcast. And remember, whether you're the world's greatest detective, the fastest man alive, or the big blue Boy Scout, or even worse, if you truly believe that the hierarchy of the DC Universe was about to change last year, don't worry. Don't let any of this news get you down. There's brighter days. There's always a tomorrow. It's up, 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 and away. And always remember that you, yes, you are worthy.